Sure.
Okay, I am very privileged to have Dr. Wayne Greaves with me. I will give his biography, a brief biography of him, and then we will get into our interview. He was born in the parish of St. Lucy, Barbados. He was educated at McGill University in Montreal, where he earned an MD in internal medicine and clinical pharmacology. He did a fellowship at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. And at the Centers for Disease Control, the CDC, in Atlanta, Georgia, he was an Epidemic Intelligence Service Officer. And essentially, he was a sleuth who was tracking down disease vectors and outbreaks. And later, he was a visiting scientist in the Sexually Transmitted Diseases Division. So this is some serious stuff. From 1984 to 1997, he was an associate professor of medicine at the Howard University College of Medicine. And of course, Howard University is my alma mater. And in this interview, we mostly are going to focus on Dr. Greaves' time at the Howard University College of Medicine. While there, from 1993 to 1995, he was the director of the AIDS Clinical Trials Unit at Howard University. From 1997 to 2009, he was the clinical project director of immunology and infectious diseases and the senior director of global clinical research at the Sharing Plow Research Institute in Kenilworth, New Jersey. And I think that's, just to orient you all, I think that's about 45 minutes from Manhattan. And since 2009, he has been the executive director of infectious diseases at the Merck Research Laboratories, and that's also in New Jersey. He was honored with the President's Award for his contribution to HIV/AIDS research, and he is one of the brains behind the first 3-in-1 HIV/AIDS pill that was approved by the US FDA. And Dr. Greaves, for our purposes, and especially for this interview, it's important to point out that you are credited with being, some sources say, the first, like the Washington Post says the first, but certainly one of the first researchers to alert the public, alert the world of the peril of HIV/AIDS for Black people. And so it is, like I said, it is my pleasure and privilege to be interviewing you. Can you tell us, Dr. Greaves, a little bit about your early life and how you came to infectious medicine?
I think I started out by being interested in medicine from the time I was relatively young, partly because of the discussions with my dad. And coming to Montreal and going to McGill, it was just an interest to get into medicine. At that time, it wasn't specifically infectious diseases. I think that came later on through a series of events, a number of infections my wife had at some point, and it just made me become more interested in microbiology and the whole concept of infectious diseases. In the Canadian system, studying infectious diseases is more focused on microbiology compared to the United States. And so I decided to leave Montreal, come to Vanderbilt, and do clinical infectious diseases, which is more what I was interested in. And from there, you know, I moved on to the Centers for Disease Control from one of my mentors, one of my very nice professors at Vanderbilt, Dr. Schaffner, was very instrumental in helping that connection. And so it was really an excellent career choice, and I don't regret any of it at all. It's been really exciting, at times exhilarating, And this allowed me to really go places within that arena, within infectious diseases, even today.
So was there one of those moments sometime during your formative years where someone was sick or something like that, and you said it was like an aha moment, this is what I should do with my life? Or did that realization come later?
Yeah, I don't think there was an aha moment. I kind of alluded a minute ago. My wife was having some issues at one point, infectious problem, which was having some challenges for the physicians who were taking care of her. And it just made me want to delve into it deeper myself. I think that's where my interests became more crystallized, if you will. But other than that, I can't say there was an aha moment as far as infectious disease is concerned. I think along the way, like going to the CDC, going to Vanderbilt, where I was really impressed with my professors there. I mean, these guys were like walking dictionaries. I mean, I was coming from McGill, which is a mecca of medicine and training in Canada. But coming to Vanderbilt in Nashville, Tennessee, I was just awed by the knowledge that my professors had. They were like walking dictionaries. It was just incredible. And from there, moving on to CDC was just a continuation of the same.
So what sort of things do you study to become an infectious diseases doctor? What is the curriculum like for that?
So an infectious disease doctor is really a subspecialist or a specialist within the internal medicine field. So to become an infectious disease specialist, first, you need to be an internist or study internal medicine. So that's about a 3-year program. And infectious diseases after that can be 1-2 years. You can do longer if you do specific laboratory training or other training, like I did more in epidemiology and public health. So that's the basic pathway that one takes. But internal medicine is a foundation of infectious diseases.
Okay. And now when many people hear of the CDC, I don't know exactly what first comes to mind. These days, it's sort of on the center of, well, it's a political firestorm.
Yeah.
What was going to the CDC like back then? I guess you were in your 30s.
Yeah.
Sort of early 30s. What was it like back then?
Yeah, it's unfortunate that CDC has lost much of its luster. Really, very, very disappointing. Sometimes I even shudder to think that I spent years there as a visiting scientist. It's just, oh,
yeah,
not the same. So the time when I was at CDC, it was like the mecca for, you know, being on top of infectious diseases, managing outbreaks, being on the forefront, specialized knowledge. You know, one of the thrills that I had at CDC, it was really incredible when I was there. I was working at that time on rubella, you know, which is a disease that can infect people in general, but particularly bad for pregnant women, because then it can be transmitted to the fetus and cause congenital rubella syndrome, and most of those babies die. So there was a big push not only to eliminate measles, but also rubella. And I remember I was in the rubella group, and there was this Thursday afternoon, I think it was, and this radio station calls me up wanting to interview me. And I'm saying, what? I was scared to death. I've never been interviewed to go on the radio live. I mean, here I was just maybe a year or so at the CDC. But then you gradually develop confidence and you realize that, you know, you are the expert. So being at CDC was an absolutely incredible experience. And you're among people who are the best minds. It's hard to describe. It's just a treat for those who are academically inclined. And if you can marry your academic interests with your public health interests in epidemiology, I mean, there are great things that you can do. It used to be, I'd say, the mecca for infectious disease control for the rest of the world, not just the United States. People looked up to the CDC. Now it's kind of fallen in disrepute after a series of unfortunate events and missteps during the last 2 years with this COVID pandemic.
Well, what would you say, just to digress a little bit, when a pandemic maybe develops, we can say, and there is really no agreed upon knowledge of it, and it kind of takes everyone by storm. What is the disposition toward that for epidemiologists, for infectious disease specialists, and the CDC, when you really don't know and it sort of takes you by storm like it does everyone else?
Yeah. So we are prepared. We understand that we may be sent on outbreaks of disease where we don't understand what is happening. You understand that there's a risk. You may go to investigate an illness. It may be extremely infectious. You may die. But this is what you're committed to doing, to find out what's happening before it affects many other people. So one example, in my case, I was sent to investigate an outbreak in Maine. Again, this is of rubella. We didn't know it was rubella at first. All we knew was that physicians were reporting many cases among young kids and a few adults of a rash illness associated with fever. And it seemed to be spreading rather quickly. So off I was sent, hop on the plane and go, tell us what's happening. So you spend time interviewing people who are infected, their families, counting the number of cases, trying to make connections as to where it started, where it spread, and you get into your whole epidemiologic analysis. So you're underground, you're actually interacting with people. So it's exciting, but it's potentially challenging. It could be at times dangerous. In my case, it wasn't, but in some other cases, like some of the folks that I work with were sent to investigate Ebola, which is a deadly virus. So you need to be also aware of the situation, the context of the outbreak, and take appropriate precautions. No. But again, the thrill, especially when you're younger, I think as I look back now as an older person, I can't believe some of the things that I did and the risks I took. But at that time, it was like, oh, just exciting.
So even at the CDC, things can be risky when you have essentially a hazmat suit on and all the precautions. Things are still risky.
Yeah. There are certain areas, for example, even at CDC, that was off limits to me. The really, really infectious disease laboratory, where you really are in hazmat suits. You know, the folks who handle smallpox in those days, I mean, these are really high security laboratories. They're not open to the average person who works at CDC. And there is a specific process that you follow. So yes, yeah, there are different levels of containment.
And as you pointed out, and we'll get into later, I think, because I read some articles on your early AIDS research, and the path of infection was not known in many ways, you know. So you were actually coming in contact with HIV AIDS patients, and you think you know how it's spread or how it's contracted, but that's still kind of up in the air, right?
Yeah, the first cases were reported among gay men and intravenous drug users. So there was immediately a stigma attached to this. And there were all kinds of explanations and theories. You know, this was a punishment from God. You know, these were people ran all over the world, were loose people. It was coming from the Haitians. There were all kinds of conspiracy theories back then too. But with time, we realized that this was caused by a virus. It took a while. And then, you know, the French and the US were vying for who discovered it first. Then we developed better testing for the virus. And then we got to the first drug. I mean, I look back now, compared to what we're doing today, we've got nice drug cocktails, you know, two or three drugs combined in one pill. It's easy to take. In those days, the first drug we had was AZT. People were taking this like every 4 hours. They would set their alarm clocks to wake up during the night just to take this drug, because that was all we had. I mean, that's unheard of today, but that's what it was like then. And even then, the side effects were horrible, but that was all you had. We've come a long, long way.
Thanks to people like you. In the early 1980s, you're at CDC, and then you transition to Howard University College of Medicine. And this is the early 80s, 1984. And I believe that HIV/AIDS, it wasn't called that then, but it was first identified early 1980s, right? Like 1981? And this is patient zero. And I think that he was he a French airplane employee or something like that?
There's dispute whether it was French or Canadian, not sure which it was. But in those days, you're right, it was referred to as great gay-related immune disease syndrome. The name AIDS came along later on.
Okay. And so were you at CDC?
I was at CDC when it started, and okay. I left shortly after it was identified and came to Howard University. And while I was at Howard University, there was no one there doing anything in HIV/AIDS. So immediately I was able to fill a role in the vacuum and got to be connected with the NIH, National Institutes of Health, and also with the FDA. And, you know, it worked out to be a really great career path being there, coming from CDC. You know, like anything in life, connections make a big difference. And coming from CDC was like the stamp of approval to be able to easily fit in with some of these other research groups. And through the NIH, they had an initiative that also was very timely, where they were trying to help HBCUs, and particularly those with medical schools like Howard, develop the infrastructure to start an AIDS clinical research unit. And so that was really a good time for me as well, because I was able to be there to head up for a while.
So was your hiring to Howard, was that directly in relation to HIV/AIDS?
No, not at all. They were just looking for an infectious disease person to join the group. And so I think I was at Howard for a few years before we actually got that grant to really take over the AIDS clinical unit. I don't remember exactly now, but I think it was maybe a year or two after I got there.
Now, what was your mental process when you first started dealing with HIV/AIDS patients? Now, this was a time, we have to tell our listeners that this is before Magic Johnson, it's before Eazy-E, it was before relatable, even charismatic people that we think we know, that are in our households through music or what have you, and sports, before they were the face of AIDS, and it was stigmatized, as you said, as a gay person's disease, as a judgment from God, and the transmission was not known. And so what did you have to deal with mentally just to start treating and to deal with HIV/AIDS?
Yeah, so because I'd worked in the sexually transmitted field before, it wasn't as difficult for me as it may have been for some others, you know, who are devout Christians and so on, and aren't able to reach across the line to others who are not as we are. But for me, it wasn't a difficult transition. And we also realized that it wasn't only sexually transmitted. You know, at that time, we hadn't initially recognized that it could be transmitted through blood. That came quickly afterwards. But one of the celebrities who became infected and died, as you might remember, is Arthur Ashe.
Yes.
And so that put a different spin on the illness. Magic Johnson also was infected. That too put a different spin on it. Here's someone, he's married, kids and so on, big time basketball player and so on. So things began to take better shape, if you will, as key Black celebrities were affected by this. We also had a newscaster from ABC whose name escapes me right now, who was hospitalized at Howard and eventually died. And so bit by bit, people began to realize not only did it not only affect gay men, but in fact, the realization came to some people, look, there are many people who are gay whom you don't know. And what are you going to do? Are you going to disown them just because they're gay? So people had to make decisions, you know, are you going to love your son or whomever, or are you going to just dump them just because they're gay? So it was a time of reckoning for a lot of families, a lot of people, and some physicians too.
And then
there was a stigma, but, you know, there was a time where undertakers didn't want to have funerals for these people. It really got to be absolutely ridiculous. You know, we spent time, a lot of education, you know, here's how you can protect yourself. Doesn't mean you can't still have funerals. There are just some, you know, precautions you need to follow. But it's not the end of the world.
Yes. Now, where were you and let's say in your developmental thinking on HIV/AIDS, when it was discovered that it could be transferred through blood. I mean, I know that in the early 80s, I think that Haiti had a case, Doc, and this could be a conspiracy theory, but cases of plasma were shipped to Haiti, and the plasma had the HIV/AIDS in the plasma, is that correct?
And it's quite possible.
Massive amount of Haitian citizens got it. So is that kind of the time when they realized that it could be transmitted through blood?
Yeah, I think it was recognized before that. I think that was just an incident where precautions weren't followed properly. And there have been cases, you know, where there have been missteps and mishaps, even when we knew that it could be transmitted through blood transfusions and through blood that's not proper. So then each episode led to refinement in the protocols as to, for example, who can donate blood and how blood should be handled and so on. So I guess it's a lot like how we've had to handle the COVID-19 pandemic. You know, we at first were saying, don't bother with masks. We've come around to saying, you really need masks. And so by a process of analyzing what happened and the likely path or route of transmission, we bit by bit refined our precautions and our guidelines. And I think that's the way science works. You know, I think we learn from our mistakes and we improve. Some people find that difficult to understand the whole scientific method and process. Why are you always changing your mind? Well, we change our mind as we get additional knowledge. I know it's not very comforting to you, but that's what we need to do as we advance in knowledge. So yes, you do need to wear masks now.
Yes. Now, two questions, and one is philosophical and one is practical. Why do you think there is always such stigmatization around infectious diseases and pandemics? And then number two, how did that get in the way of the development of the treatment of HIV/AIDS?
So I wouldn't say that there's always stigmatization with infectious diseases. Certainly with pneumonia, there's not that stigmatization. Maybe there's a little bit for tuberculosis, but still nothing like what we see with HIV. HIV had its own baggage because the first cases were reported in individuals in society whom people often look down on or have various ideas about. Gay men, intravenous drug users, you know, like pandemics are a little different. The issue with pandemics is the fear factor and the uncertainty principle. Human beings like to know that there's some certainty about their lives. They know tomorrow the sun will come up, the sun will set. They want some constancy. When you can't explain things that you see happening around you, I think the human mind tries to make sense of it and invent explanations, hence the origin of conspiracy theories. And sometimes these conspiracy theories, although they may be totally irrational and make no sense to some of us, to the individual, that's their solace. That's their explanation and their rationalization. You can't take it away from them because that's all they want. That's all they can see. And this is why it's so difficult to eradicate conspiracy theories. And sad to say, sometimes there are actually a few of them that turned out to be true. We just weren't open enough as scientists to understand.
And especially among Blacks, when the, you know, African Americans, there were entire government conspiracies that were perpetrated on us, slavery, and of course, medically, you know, the start of gynecology, Tuskegee experiment, you know, on and on and on. And so there is a ready audience for conspiracy theories.
Absolutely. In the Black community, there's no doubt about it. I mean, the experiments on syphilis, where men could have been treated, but weren't treated just to follow the disease course, is horrendous and horrible to think about. And to make it even worse, US Public Health Service recruited a prominent Black nurse to be one of the leaders in the whole exercise. I mean, is despicable. And you know, for folks who live through that, I mean, it's, you reflect on that. And the other cases we know, you know, gynecologist Sims just operating on Black women with anesthesia.
Oh, yeah.
And then in Baltimore, you know, the whole concept of the HeLa cells and the cancer cells that we use for so many experiments, and the poor woman was never told what they were doing, taking her cells while they were using them for medical reasons. So there are lots of historical reasons and the basis why one can understand the perception among many Blacks is you can't trust the government. You can't trust the medical establishment.
Yes.
Unfortunately, what I tried to do, though, to get rid of some of that is to explain, look, because of those things, there are now other steps in place that it won't happen, at least not like that. But that's a very hard story to sell. And so it sometimes is very difficult. But, you know, it has its downside, I must say, because what I've found now is that many, many, many Black patients I've had to care for, even simple things like hypertension, where you know that these drugs can prevent strokes, heart attacks, kidney damage, end up on dialysis, but they won't take pills. There's this fair, total rejection. No pills, no medicines, only natural stuff. And in some cases, while I am totally for natural stuff as a first step, because sometimes that's all you need, but there are many cases where the natural remedies are inadequate.
Yes.
You can bring the blood pressure down so much, but not enough. And it's so difficult to convince some of our people that you do need to be on medication. That is a continuing battle.
Now, Doc, when I was reading about your time at Howard University and your identification of AIDS as an absolute peril to the Black community, I was thinking gay men, intravenous drug users, and Black people. Black people were in many ways as verboten as the other two groups to white people in America. And so when you first identified that AIDS is, it could be a menace and it's afflicting the Black community, I would think that, and from what I understand, there was still grudging assistance to really get to the bottom of the HIV/AIDS crisis. What do you think about that?
I'll say two things. One is that even in the Black community, I was ostracized because it was like, who is he coming up here from CDC to point fingers at us and tell us that the Black community is affected by this? This is no disease that affects Black people. This only affects the gay white people. And so for a while, it was like, what are you talking about? You better go back to CDC where you came from. So it took a while. Are all folks, you know? So it wasn't an easy transition initially to be speaking out in the AIDS arena at that time. But to the other point that I think you're alluding to, yeah, it took some time before the public health authorities and the government at large were willing to put money and effort, targeted efforts, recognizing that this was a serious problem in the Black community and in other communities of color as well, but they were not very quick to address the issue, just like they weren't quick to address the problem of opioid addiction in the Black community at that time. Today, it's a quite different story, as you know.
Yes.
But in those days, no. This is affecting Black folks. Not a big deal.
And in many ways, there were a number of sectors that coalesced to move the arm of the government and other entities. Like weren't there massive grassroots protests about getting assistance for AIDS that really helped move that along?
Yes, I think, and in fairness, I must say that some of it actually did come from, let us say, more enlightened white colleagues and folks, as often happens. So it took some in the Congressional Black Caucus. Mm-hmm. It took people at the historically Black colleges and universities. And it took, you know, grassroots individuals, including some gay movements and groups, to coalesce, to come together, to really build pressure up. And I must say, I really do have to give kudos to the National Institutes of Health and Dr. Fauci and his group. I've known Dr. Fauci for a long time. He was helpful, along with others in the group and at the FDA, in helping to recognize that there was a need for funding and help to minority institutions like Howard University. And so we actually received a very nice grant to get us started in our AIDS clinical trials unit. And so a number of other centers were funded as well, not only Black institutions, but other minority groups. But that was the beginning, I think, of a more comprehensive approach to looking at the problem and beginning to address the issues that we talked about for a while.
Now, when did you discover that HIV/AIDS was such a threat to the Black community? And what was the process like of letting everyone know that?
I think I realized that soon after I came to Howard, as the numbers became more obvious. Yeah, it may have started in gay populations or among users who injected drugs, but it was clear as we got more data and you began to look at the breakdown, you know, the typical things that we look at, age, sex, race, and so on, you began to see who was being affected. The fact that it was disproportionately affecting Black men, Black women, Black kids. And then you can also geographically see which areas are being affected. It became quickly obvious to me. And I must say that the CDC group at that time, my friend, Dr. Jaffe, Harold Jaffe at that time, he was really aware and he was helpful actually in kind of guiding me along as I went through this process. And so I think there was recognition. Yep, here's someone that's come from CDC. He has the support of his colleagues at CDC. He's saying this. He's not saying anything that's not true. Maybe we should listen. And there was a gradual, and then there were also my colleagues at the other schools at Morehouse, Drew, who were also becoming involved.
Now you speak of the ridicule you received, you speak of threats that you received. What was that like?
Well, the ridicule was surprising. That really took me by surprise. I wasn't used to that. I mean, I was still relatively young then in my career. I wasn't used to speaking in public and being taunted or contradicted publicly. I mean, the closest was at CDC, as I said, you're interviewed on the radio, you're kind of respected and you're in your little niche, you're protected. But in the real world, in the community, you know, anything goes and they don't like what you're saying. Who are you coming to tell us about this stuff in our community and our Black folks? So there were some pretty strident voices. I think my reaction was mostly to say, look, I'm just sharing information with you to see if you can understand what I'm saying, the fact that we need to look out for our people and protect them. That was the attitude and the approach that I took, rather than saying, you know, this is bad, da, 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 da. So, and I did have some people who were understanding and recognizing what I was saying. There was good support. I think the few who were strident and very negative were the minority.
Okay. Now, I was born in 79. So I was, when I was very young, I think I was the part of the generation that was traumatized by HIV/AIDS, because we would see Time magazine, we would see Newsweek, with people with hollowed out, sunken cheeks, emaciated, frail, and we grew up with this, with the stigma of HIV/AIDS, and so you were on the front lines dealing with it. What was it actually like to see AIDS patients? Because some of the articles that I read, you were actually treating them face-to-face.
Yeah.
What was that like, and maybe how was it different from the media coverage?
Yeah, so the media tended to sensationalize things as they typically do, but some of it was real. You know, I've had patients who were like skin and bones, you're right, they were wasting away. And that's one of the ways that HIV presented at the time, with a wasting illness. And so this led some individuals on the outside, even those with little knowledge of medicine, to point fingers. Oh, he's losing weight, she's losing weight, he must have AIDS, let's stay far away. And then the other stigma had to do with those, and this was mostly in gay men, who developed a condition we call Kaposi sarcoma. And this was often associated with skin lesions. And so these are often like black and blue or bruises. And so again, here people would point fingers, he has leprosy, stay away from him. So Kaposi sarcoma became, in a sense, the leprosy for many gay men who were afflicted with HIV. And those things really sometimes got in the way of people seeking care, and also marginalizing even further those who were already afflicted with HIV. So it was complicated. And I was just thinking back to the person's name, I can't remember, Max Robinson, prominent newscaster back in the day. When he came down with this, that was another impetus. Again, I gave a little bit more push to the fact that this is something that can affect Black people, not only Arthur Ashe and Magda Johnson.
Okay, so your work at Howard, you are, when you're treating patients, when you're treating AIDS patients, you are not only, you're diagnosing and you're learning things, you're gathering information, but you're also trying to treat them with the very basic knowledge that you have. Is that correct?
Yeah, and as I said, you know, the knowledge increased over time. In the early days, we basically had one drug, and that was AZT that we would use. There would be other supportive things that we'll do to keep them going and, you know, keep them free from unnecessary pain. Sometimes they have diarrhea, so you treat the diarrhea. You know, you treat the symptoms to minimize the disruption to their regular lifestyle. But for the most part, a lot of our efforts were focused on targeting the virus as best as we can with the drugs that we had at that time. And of course, enforcing precautions so that individuals working with the infected person didn't become infected themselves. For example, nurses, we had to really push and keep emphasizing the importance of what we called at that time blood and body fluid precautions and handling sharps like needles very, very carefully, because inevitably a nurse or a technician would stick themselves with a needle, and then there's total panic and pandemonium. You're trying to counsel them, you're trying to provide some solace, and you put them on prophylactic regimen drugs. It was complicated.
Doc, did people get infected from that? Did any nurse? Yeah.
Not any of the ones that work with me, no. But yes, there are cases reported in the medical literature where not a lot, a few individuals who worked with HIV patients became infected through needle stick injuries, yes.
Because you
unfortunately, a very, very small number.
Yeah, you often hear about people who got blood transfusions in those days and who died from HIV AIDS complications. But nurses, that would be heartrending.
Yeah, but it was very, very rare. And in most cases, you know, we were on top of it quickly and they were treated. Most of them were able to live for a long time. I don't know that any that I know personally died, but the good thing about it is that because the science evolved so rapidly, many of the drugs came along after AZT. So we then started to work with cocktails. Yes. And then there were better and better drugs. Some of the patients that I had in those early days at Harvard who died, if I had the drugs that came along a few years later, they probably would be still alive. I mean, look at Magic Johnson. I mean, Magic Johnson was infected long, long ago. When I was at Howard just after a year or two, that was when the news broke. And here he is doing as well as ever today. And it's a testament, I think, to science. It's a testament to having a good medical care, because if you don't have good medical care, you still may not have access to the best drugs. And so it is possible.
Now, what was your role in the development of 3-in-1 medication?
So Howard University was one of the centers that participated in the clinical trials. And this network of clinical trials was how the National Institutes of Health conducted the studies to determine whether or not one drug, two drugs, three drugs would be better, you know, over a wide group of people. We needed large numbers of individuals. So we were one of those centers at Howard.
Okay. Now, just coming from a Christian context, did you get some blowback for when you were recommending certain preventive measures like condoms and clean needles? Were you getting some blowback from Christian people about that?
Because
I saw the coverage. You're like, I'm saying I'm promoting abstinence, but if you're not abstinent, then you should wear a condom. And immediately some Christians would say, oh no, you know.
Yeah. There was some of that. It wasn't as bad as I had anticipated, because I started with abstinence, but I said, you know, but if you can't do that, it's like what I say now about the COVID vaccine. Look, the COVID vaccine is what I think is the best approach. But if you're not going to take it, and I certainly can't make you take it, then you need to take care of yourself. And at least you should do this. So yeah, there was that pushback. And in some settings, I wouldn't mention any of the other methods, actually, just out of respect to the institution, if it were one of our Christian schools or something like that. I'd say, like, you know, this is the ideal. It's not the ideal for everyone, and you have to understand that. Mm-hmm. To you, this is what is normal and ideal. To people in the world who have no idea or no interest in God, that's not the way they live their lives. Yeah. And they can still be protected. And I can't be so irresponsible as a professional that I don't want to give them the advice that can also save their lives. Mm-hmm. And that's one important point that I find troubling among some of our Adventist professionals, but maybe Christian professionals, not just Adventists, that they feel they can't give advice if it's not the best advice from a spiritual standpoint. And I totally disagree with that. I think that people have to be met where they are. And until they're at the place where that's the only option that they see as viable, to me, you have to give them the options that will help them save themselves so they can get to the point where they can move to the next level.
Yes. If you can think of a really remarkable HIV/AIDS story, maybe one of your patients, or does something jump out from those years?
Yeah, there are two I should tell you about. First was a young physician, and he was admitted to the hospital over the weekend. I came in to make rounds with my team, and I was about to head out. And just as I was leaving the building, I got this call on my pager to come up to see this young doctor who was one of our trainees. So I go to see him, and I walk into the room, and he was just bawling, crying. Here's a big man crying. And I'm trying to console him. And after maybe at least 2 to 3 minutes of just crying, he comes down and he says to me, "Well, Dr. Greaves, I don't want to die. I don't want to die." So at that point, I really hadn't quite got his full story. And then he got to tell me then his lifestyle, and did he was gay. His parents didn't know. Here he was at Howard. And, you know, he doesn't want to die. He doesn't want to die. I have to save him. So over time, we built up a close connection. I tried to reassure him the best as I can. I can't promise him that, and I will do the absolute best I can for him. It got to the point on that very first visit, each time I tried to leave him, he would just grab a hold of my hand, and I just couldn't leave him. And it took a long, long time. And it really, I think, made me stop and realize even more than I had at the time the depth of despair that people can sink to, and the fear that can come over a person, especially a young person, when they look towards a future that they thought they had, which they no longer would have. So it was a pretty intense experience, emotional on both sides. He eventually did die many months after, but by then he had, I think, begun to accept things better and took care of some of the things that he needed to take care of. The other case is another sad one.
Dr. Ruka, if I can ask you a question about that. What do you think the biggest fear was? Was it the marginalization and rejection of people, or was it death? Maybe both?
Yeah, both. The first one was shame.
Shame, yeah.
He felt shame, ashamed that people would see him as someone who's gay, someone who is not worthy. Didn't want his parents to know that. Didn't want his colleagues to know that. So shame, I think, was the overriding emotion, at least initially. And I think we underestimate the impact that shame has on people. It can be devastating. It destroys a person's hope. And I think if we even think back to the Garden of Eden, you know, I think we forget, but I think that one of the first emotions that was experienced by Adam and Eve is shame, not so much fear. I think fear was there, but I think shame was the biggest downer. So yeah, so shame, and then as he kind of got past that, then the next thing was death, fear of death at such a young age. So the other case was an Adventist woman who was referred to me because she had received a transfusion and was determined to be infected. And she came over to see me, didn't have any symptoms, anything to worry about too much, but she was just, you know, destroyed psychologically by that diagnosis. And so she was really referred to me for confirmation and for treatment and so on. And this is a sad story, but it had a good ending. So I see her, I check her over, nothing dramatic, just the fact that she was allegedly infected. The tests came back confirming that she indeed had HIV infection, and had a long discussion, herself and her husband, gave her some time to think about it, and we were going to start therapy soon afterwards. She was a very devout woman, and she, crying and praying at the same time, came back to see me after the weekend and said, "Dr. Greaves, can you do one more thing for me? Can you just check this blood one more time? Test me one more time." I tested her one more time, and this time the blood test came back negative. She's all excited, of course, right? God has worked a miracle. And I don't want to say God can't work miracles, but now I became suspicious. So I got into the laboratory. I said to the laboratory folks, "Let's check what happened here. Are you sure this is the right result or the one before?" So that was done carefully and carefully. And it turned out that her initial test was incorrect. It wasn't her blood. She was never positive. But for her, it was a miracle that occurred. And I left it there for her sake. I chose not to go back and say anything. That's how she wanted to believe it. Fine. But I say that to you to tell you what can happen in reality in the world. Not to say God can't work miracles, but here's a case where.
Yes.
Bless her heart.
Two of the biggest questions about AIDS, I want your expert weigh in: the origin of AIDS and will there be a cure for AIDS? What do you think, where do you think, how do you think AIDS originated?
So I know it's not popular to say this, but I've looked into the data a lot. And I do think that AIDS began in the wild, most likely in monkeys, and spread from there to humans. How the spread occurred is not quite clear. Some say that it's because of man encroaching on their territories, scratches from monkeys, others say it's eating monkey food, meat, and so on. I have no idea. But we do know that there is precedent for viruses making the transition or the jump from animals to humans.
Yes.
And that is my understanding, and that's how I accept that this occurred. Just like, you know, again, there's precedent. Wild birds, influenza viruses, onto man. Mm-hmm. SARS viruses, through an intermediate host, you know, civet cats in the first SARS outbreak back in Toronto 2003, then via camels into humans in the MERS outbreak. This one we don't know was intermediate host, but we know again that these viruses are endemic in bats, for example. These are the coronaviruses now. So I think in the case of HIV, it probably did begin in some species of monkey, and then it crossed over to man. Whether or not there's going to be a cure is a very difficult thing to say. And I would preface this by saying that we are not able to cure most viral diseases. Hepatitis C might be the exception. We are able to prevent them. And this is why vaccines are so important. We haven't cured smallpox. It doesn't exist anymore as far as we know because of such a good vaccination campaign worldwide. It's almost true for polio, but there's still some polio in isolated areas where the vaccine hasn't been taken up as much as it should have been. So most viral diseases we're talking about controlling as opposed to curing. Herpes virus, for example, we've got good drugs, suppresses the virus, doesn't really cure them. Hepatitis C is probably one of the outstanding exceptions. And we may do better with time, you know. I'm not saying we won't be able to cure some viral diseases, but the problem with it, curing a viral disease, is that viruses tend to live within cells. And so to kill the virus, you have to kill the cell. And so you're, in a sense, attacking your own body. And if there's that much virus around, you may be destroying so much of your own cells that it causes really bad side effects just from using these antiviral medications.
Like radiation for cancer?
Yeah, somewhat the same concept. You're destroying cells to get rid of the cancer. You're destroying cells to get rid of the virus. Now, in some cases, you can interfere with the viral life cycle without destroying the human life cycle, but it's still a little tricky. You know, we do that with HIV, but HIV lives in certain reservoirs within the body where it's hard to get to the virus itself. And they can become dormant. And if they're not dividing, then the drugs that we use don't really have much of an effect on the virus. So it's very difficult. I think it's more likely, it's been very, very difficult to develop a vaccine for HIV because the virus mutates so rapidly, so often, and becomes resistant easily even to the drugs. So I don't foresee a cure for HIV anytime soon, but we've now reached a point where we can control it pretty well. The current drugs that we have, the current cocktails, people can live a normal lifespan pretty much.
And has that sort of, I would say, not arrested, but slowed down the drive to find a cure? The fact that it can be treated effectively?
I want to say a little bit, but the drive is more to find better and better antiviral drugs as opposed to finding the vaccine, because the vaccine work has been fraught with so many failures and frustration that I think there's less incentive to keep trying to find a vaccine that will work given the rapid mutation rate of the virus, that there's more and more work being done in terms of finding better antiviral agents that are not toxic, that can be taken less frequently. I mean, now we're talking about an injection that you can probably take for 3 months and, you know, keep this virus quiet, suppressed, not causing any problems. I suspect we'll even go further with time. So there's been a tremendous amount of work on the research end, looking for new antiviral drugs, less so for the vaccine, but I wouldn't say that it's dead. There's still some work going on.
Could you speculate on the if there ever was a cure for HIV AIDS, how would it look? What, in your expert opinion, what sort of mode would it take? What are the most fruitful areas now that scientists are looking at, or researchers, AIDS researchers are looking at for a cure?
So I think where we would be looking, where we are looking, as I said, is more in terms of suppressing the virus in those who are infected so they can't pass it on.
Okay.
And also finding drugs to enter the reservoirs where the virus tends to live in the body. So we can eradicate it, not suppress it. So there is a lot of work on eradicating the virus in those who are infected and not just suppressing it.
Okay.
It will still require behavioral adaptation on the part of humans. Because if one person is infected, let's say, and sexually transmits it to another individual, if you have good antiviral drugs, then yes, you can eradicate it from that person, but it means doing that over and over again. Mm-hmm. But still, that would represent a bit of a breakthrough, because right now we're talking, the best we can do is to keep the virus at a very, very low level, so it's undetectable, but it's not completely gone. If we could eradicate the virus, to me, that would be a definite step forward. There are a couple of very exceptional cases where that has happened, but not so much from antiviral drugs. It's more so from more natural, in a few rare cases, immunity, the genetic makeup. But there's a lot of work still going on there. So yeah, HIV research is not dead at all, not dull. In fact, we've got what we call now multi-drug resistant HIV. And so this is another reason why we continue to develop better and better drugs to be able to address those cases.
Just two more questions, Doc. What was your reaction when you saw the march of HIV/AIDS on sub-Saharan Africa and the way that it devastated? I mean, this is a broad question, but what was your reaction? One of the first in the U.S. who sort of blew the whistle on how it was affecting the Black community. What did you think when it just devastated sub-Saharan Africa?
I think I felt despair and sadness more than anything else, because I knew that this was a massive problem. I knew there wasn't going to be the political will or the economy of scale to address it the way it would need to be addressed. And I just pictured people dying of wasting illness, bare bones, diarrhea, widespread lesions. It wasn't a good picture that I conjured up in my mind. And South Africa, of course, perhaps the place that would have the most resources, good research set in and money compared to other places, you know, Zaire at that time, Congo now, other places where the disease was rampant.
And it's mostly in the poor Black areas.
Yeah, mostly in sub-Saharan Africa.
Places like that, yeah.
Yeah, now, fortunately, things... Sorry, go ahead.
Did you visit Africa?
Yeah, I spent some time in Malawi, where we had an education program through Howard University. I went over to Zaire, at that time Zaire, and met with some individuals there. And Kenya is another place that I visited. And Zaire was the place that struck me the most. When I was in Zaire, I visited the hospital, and they were boiling their needles and syringes to reuse again and again and again, because they had so few resources. They had to reuse their needles, and they kept boiling them over and over and over. And some of them were obviously very dull. And it was just sad to talk to the doctors who were there, but that was the difficulty at that time. Now, mind you, I'm talking about years ago, but that was what was seen then. Things were really not good. Malawi wasn't in as bad a shape as that, but Zaire is what stood out to me at that time. I keep saying Zaire, not the name is Congo, but yeah.
Now, was boiling effective, Doc?
Yeah, boiling would destroy the virus. I forget how many minutes, but they were also disinfecting using sodium hypochlorite as well.
Okay.
So they were actually doing both, but the boiling part was what really struck me. And the other thing they were doing was the gloves. They're also, that was their way of reusing them. And yeah, obviously there were holes, so they're having to use several pairs of gloves. You know, we talk about it. We live here in the United States, so we don't really appreciate sometimes the situations that exist in other countries, particularly countries that are really, really just developing countries on a lower scale.
Yeah.
It's staggering to sometimes see what people have to deal with and to live through.
Last question for you, Dr. Greaves. How did your Seventh-day Adventist faith play into and impact and influence your time as an AIDS pioneer, as it were?
I think it was vital for me anyways, as a basis for compassion and willingness to help those who were suffering. And I've come to the realization that if there's one virtue that I think we need to develop further, it's not our doctrines, it's compassion. I think if a person genuinely has compassion for someone who's less fortunate or suffering, it tends to push prejudice aside and push our ideas of pride and hubris away from us. It allows us to reach out to the other person's spirit and soul, to almost touch them. And they see that you are compassionate. It's like, you know, where the Bible talks that Jesus draws us through love and kindness.
Right.
To me, that is so important. You know, you can have all the knowledge in the world. You can be the best scientist. You can be the best doctor. But when you're genuinely concerned for people, it shows. And it keeps you motivated and it keeps you going despite the difficult situations that you face. And for me, that was the motivating force or factor. I felt compassion for those folks who were afflicted with HIV because I knew how terrible it was. The stigma they face, the ostracism they face, even from their own families, sometimes their own churches. And so that's where I think my upbringing, my faith, you know, I would like to think that it is my Seventh-day Adventist faith, but really, I'm not sure I want to say it that way. I would rather say the essence of compassion is more important than a particular denomination.
Yes.
And so that's where I would land on this question, the answer to your question.
Powerful, powerful. Dr. Greaves, thank you so much for your time and, more importantly, salute to your life's work. You truly are doing the work of Jesus, and we salute you. Thank you.
Thank you.